course. So if you're looking to take the MCAT this year and going to look into a prep program for that, it's a great opportunity to see what's out there and see what program is best for you. I've got some flyers here that I'll pass out, and hope to see you guys tomorrow.
All right. She said 2 seconds, and that was just about 2 seconds. Wow. How's everybody doing today?
Amazing.
Amazing. Look what I brought. Okay. I think what I will do to keep things from getting too chaotic right now is I will finish a little early, I promise, and then I'll split it up and then you guys can come and get them. Please note a couple things. One, I want everybody to come get their own card. I want everybody to get one card. Okay? Now, I know I'm kind of weird and picky about this, but there's a reason that I do this. And part of the reason is rooted as follows. I want you to have a note card, and I want you to learn what that note card will tell you. That is, what you'll discover if you haven't used note cards before is that organizing the note card will actually organize your mind probably better than anything else that's out there. Most people, when they have a note card that they've organized, they find they don't actually use it very much. That's fine, okay? If you use it a lot, that's fine too. But what you learn in doing this is actually what you get from making the note card. So at the reason I ask you to turn your note card in with your exam is I keep the note cards. And I don't do that to be mean. I've seen some beautiful cards. But the reason I keep them is there's benefit in you making that note card. If you got the note card from your friend from last year, you didn't get the benefit of making it, and you don't get that organizational process. Okay? So that's why I require you to get the note card from me and to turn the card in with your exam. You're welcome to photocopy that, but I will not give you the card back. Yes? Yes, the question, that's a common question. The question is, will I still be giving you all the equations and all the information I generally give on the front of the exam? And the answer is yes, I will. Okay? So you don't have to waste your space on that. Okay? Shannon?
I just wondered, because you're letting us have a note card, are the questions going to be...
Another common question. He's giving us a note card, now he's going to make the exam twice as hard as usual. No. All right? I don't change the exam in any way as a result of giving you the note card. The format of the exam will be exactly the same. And interestingly, what I see is that the curve on the exam usually isn't significantly different. Okay? So I've never seen note cards raise it dramatically or drop it dramatically. So I find that the range of scores that we see on an exam that are typical with a note card are very common to what we see with those without a note card. Yes, ma'am?
Is the exam going to be more heavily weighted towards the new stuff and just some old stuff?
Okay, so good questions. Is the exam more heavily weighted towards the new stuff compared to the old stuff? Well, I haven't made it yet, but I will tell you what I will do in organizing and writing the exam. The new stuff, that is the material since the last exam, will be proportional to its coverage in the class. Right? So if I have covered, I forget probably what it is, 6 lectures or so since the last exam for the new material, then 6 divided by 30, roughly 20 to 30% of the exam will be new material. The rest of the stuff will be material that we've already gone over. Okay? The exam is worth 45% of your grade. You like that or you don't like that? No.
Miserable.
Miserable. It means that you probably don't want to blow off that exam. Yeah. I saw another hand back here. Was that the question that you had? Yeah.
Will it be longer?
That's a good question also. I tend to make the exam on the final about 150 points. So it's about roughly 50% longer. And you've got twice as much time to take it. So again, I really don't think the time will be an issue for you on this exam. Okay? Shannon?
Since new material is proportional to its coverage in class, is the other material also proportional to its coverage in class?
Yes, I try to keep everything proportional to its coverage in the class. So, you know, it's not exact. And some things actually, you know, some topics actually span various ranges. Allosteric interactions, for example. We talked about new stuff. We talked about old stuff with that. So they span various areas. Yeah?
The final in this room?
The final is right here in this room. It's on Monday at 9:30 a.m., and I'll ask you to come in and seat yourselves as we seated ourselves on the last two exams. So one there, one here, and one over there, and then sit in the odd-numbered ones relative to that. Same thing up there. Yes? A lot of questions, yeah.
Will we be able to pick up this exam
Will you be able to pick up this exam? Certainly. You can always pick up the exam after it's graded. But in all likelihood, you probably won't see it until after you get back from Christmas break. Yeah.
But yeah, we just
were curious.
If you live here?
What's that?
If we live here.
If you live here, you are welcome. If you camp outside my door, once it's done, you're welcome to it. So, yeah. I won't mail it to you. I get that request sometime.
Really?
And I won't scan it and email it to you either. So, yes, sir.
That being the case, there won't be an option to review and appeal the final?
Okay, so there's the question about reviewing and appealing the final. You always have the opportunity to do that. But I find that students, and that's why I sent that message out last night, are really getting in this mode that once I get an exam back, I got to get an appeal in. And I want to caution you on that. That's not a good idea to just routinely think that's going to happen. All right? Appeals are for mistakes. Appeals are for, I thought I should have one more point. Okay, that's not what appeals are about. They're about, a mistake was made on my exam. This person didn't understand what I was writing. Here's what I said. Okay? Those are mistakes. So I don't want people thinking, yes, you can appeal, certainly. All right? But you know, I don't want you just going and automatically thinking in your mindset, I've got to appeal just because I've gotten the exam back, because that's just not what this is about. If I'm not careful with that, I have 250 exams to regrade. And that's not the reason we grade exams in the first place, is to redo that. So we do take care of mistakes. Okay. And I don't do that to be mean. But I want you to look at your exams. I want you to think about your exams. And I will tell you that we're not perfect at what we do at grading. Okay? We're not perfect at writing our exams, and we're not perfect at grading our exams. And when we make mistakes, yes, I will definitely take care of those mistakes. But I think that review process is good for you, and I think looking those exams over is also very good for you. So I encourage you to do that. I don't mean to be discouraging or anything in that respect. And as I said, I don't do this to be mean, but there are logistics in terms of how many of you there are here. Yes, Kenneth. Are there extra credits in the final? Well, I don't know. It may depend on how loudly people sing. Not to say that we're going to be doing any more singing, because I don't know if we are or not. But if we have any more singing, then I guess if I hear loud singing, then we might have extra credit on the final. Is that a fair thing? Okay. You guys have been the loudest singing class I've ever had. So, truly, you win the prize. I'm very impressed with that. So that's been cool.
Will there be another optional review session out of class time before the final?
Will there be another optional review session? Yeah, I posted it on the webpage. So the review session is on Friday night at 6:30 in ALS 4001. And yes, I will videotape that. And it's listed on the webpage. Right behind my head, right there where it says, review session December 2nd at 6:30 in ALS 4001. I will videotape the session as usual. Otherwise, it's kind of a hidden thing. Are you guys going to make a 76.5% on the final?
Probably not.
I would be so happy. I was very pleased with the last exam, I have to say. Would I shave my head?
Oh.
No. But... Wait. Okay, wait. Here's what I will do. I made this bet with a student earlier in the term that I would do a lock of my hair blue if a certain thing happened. And she won. And so I don't know if you noticed, but at least one day of the term, I had a sort of a blue streak in my hair. And I didn't scrub it out. It just, when I washed my hair, the damn thing just washed out. But I'm willing to consider things like that. Yes. Yeah. I like my hair. I mean, I'm worried if I cut it, what's going to happen, right? I mean, I don't have much. I always worry, will it grow back, right? So when you've got this little out here, I shouldn't say up here, but this little out here, you have to think about those things. My Einstein look. Maybe we shouldn't do lecture day. What do you guys think?
Yep.
Just do twice as fast on Friday? No. I told a lot of you I had jury duty, and I was afraid I wasn't even going to be here today. And I encourage everybody to go do jury duty. It's a very important thing as a citizen to go and do. And when I got to jury duty on Tuesday, what they said was going to be one day, it turns out they put me into a trial for 3 days that started yesterday. And I'm going, oh my, you know what. And so I had made arrangements earlier if I couldn't give this lecture that somebody else was going to give the lecture for me. But it's the first time I've ever been actually going through the process. It was really interesting. Have you done jury duty? Yeah. It's a really interesting process. I really encourage you to go do it. And so we sat, and they call people up, and they interview, and they decide who they're going to take. Well, they didn't even call me up. So I just sat there all of yesterday morning waiting to be called. I didn't get called. I got excused. And so you guys have to listen to me today as a result. So anyway, but it's a cool process. I encourage people to participate in that process. All right, enough said. We need to get to biochemistry. And we need to talk now about what is a fairly complicated regulatory scheme. Now, I'm going to try to keep it as simple as I can for you, but there are a lot of details to glycogen metabolism regulation that we need to consider. Okay? So last time, what I talked to you about was how we broke down glycogen and how we made glycogen. And as I said, those are probably the two simplest metabolic pathways that you'll ever learn. All right? There's not much to the breakdown and the making of glycogen. There is a lot to the regulation. Now, when we look at the regulation of glycogen metabolism, of the enzymes that I've told you about so far, only two of them are regulated. That's the glycogen phosphorylase and the glycogen synthase. Let's take a close look at these at the glycogen phosphorylase. You'll notice that this enzyme has a couple of things. It has what we call two states, and these two states differ in their looseness or tightness. That's the R and the T. Okay? So we have an R state and we have a T state. Now, what complicates things for glycogen phosphorylase is glycogen phosphorylase also has two different covalent states. All right? Meaning there's a covalent modification of the enzyme. The covalent modification of the enzyme is either a phosphorylation or a dephosphorylation of the enzyme, putting a phosphate on or taking a phosphate off. Each subunit gets a phosphate, or can get a phosphate. Okay? Each form of the enzyme can exist in an R state and a T state. So we have glycogen phosphorylase A, which is the form that has phosphate. It can exist in an R state, and it can exist in a T state. We have glycogen phosphorylase B, which doesn't have the phosphate, and it can exist in an R state and a T state. So now we see we actually have four different forms of the enzyme. R state and T state for each of the glycogen phosphorylase A and the glycogen phosphorylase B. Okay. Important to keep that in mind. Now, your book shows some figures that say, here's what happens in muscle, here's what happens in liver, and they're right. But I'm not going to focus so much on differences between liver and muscle. I may tell you a couple, but that's not the main point of what I'm going to show you. Okay? I'm going to describe to you glycogen phosphorylase B as glycogen phosphorylase B and just leave it at that. I'm not going to think muscle, but did this come from muscle, where did it come from? It is important ultimately where it came from, but for our purposes of just general understanding, we'll treat glycogen phosphorylase B as just glycogen phosphorylase B and glycogen phosphorylase A as just A, irrespective of where it came from. There are some differences, but we'll leave them simple. Okay? All right. So let's start thinking about glycogen phosphorylase B. Okay? Well, actually, before I do that, let's do this. Here's the four forms. Okay? Now, glycogen phosphorylase B is shown on the left. The top form on the left is glycogen phosphorylase B in the R state. The bottom form on the left is glycogen phosphorylase B in the T state. You'll notice that both of these lack phosphates. Okay? They lack phosphates. Glycogen phosphorylase we describe as being least active, and I'll describe to you in a minute what that means, when the phosphates are gone. Gesundheit. Okay? Glycogen phosphorylase A has phosphates, and we describe it as being the, quote, most active, and you'll see why that's the case in a minute. Okay? Glycogen phosphorylase B can be very active. When would it be most active? Well, it would be most active when it's in the R state, right? And when would it be least active? It would be least active when it's in the T state. The same is true of glycogen phosphorylase A. Glycogen phosphorylase A will be most active when it's in the R state and least active when it's in the T state. Question?
Would the T state of A be more active than the, let's say, R state of B?
Yeah, this is a good question. You guys are all analytical thinkers here. So is the T state of A more active than the R state of B? We're not going to rank them. We're not going to rank them. Okay? Well, suffice it to say that the R state, and that's a very common question, the R state of B is the most active form of B. The R state of A is the most active form of A. In essence, to answer your question, the R states of each are very active. Okay? Now, we'll see why some people, including me, will say that the phosphorylated state or the phosphorylated form is the most active and the dephosphorylated form is the least active. You'll see why that happens when I get talking about the details. Okay, the other thing I want to talk about in this figure, and this is, I hope, helping to orient your mind, okay, with respect to sort of spatiality of this thing, is that going left to right involves covalent modification. Left to right involves covalent modification, either putting a phosphate on as we're going to the right or taking a phosphate off as we're going to the left. Okay? Going up and down, R state, T state involves allosteric regulation. Up and down involves allosteric regulation. Left and right involves covalent modification. Okay, well, let's take a look now at one of these forms up close and personal. One of these forms is glycogen phosphorylase B. Okay, so we're looking now only at glycogen phosphorylase B. This is only the form with no phosphate. Both of these R states and T states of this form both lack phosphate. What you see superimposed on here is the allosteric regulation of this enzyme. Okay? AMP converts the enzyme from the T state into the R state. When do our cells have AMP? When we have low energy. When our ATP levels are very low, we start making AMP. We'll see why that happens next term. But when our energy levels are low, we start making AMP. If our energy levels are low, what do we want to do? Well, we want to break down glycogen so we have glucose so we can break it down and get energy. So in a low energy state, glycogen phosphorylase B is being activated to break down glycogen. That's good. Okay? That doesn't happen very often. That doesn't happen very often. Most of the time, ATP concentrations or glucose 6-phosphate concentrations are high enough that the enzyme is converted into the T state. In the T state, the enzyme is not very active at all. And it's for this reason that we think of the dephosphorylated form as being, quote, less active. Because most of the time, most of the B form is in the T state. Only under special circumstances is it converted into the R state. So if we were to examine the glycogen phosphorylase that you had, for example, in your muscle right now, sitting here watching this, you're not burning much energy, your ATP levels are relatively high, you won't have hardly any AMP in there because you're not exercising, your glycogen phosphorylase B is going to be in the T state. It's not going to be breaking down glycogen. That makes sense. You don't want to be breaking down glycogen when you're sitting around doing nothing. You want that glycogen to be there when you've got to run and escape or go do something exciting. Everybody with me? Okay. That is glycogen phosphorylase B. Let's look at glycogen phosphorylase A. Let's start on this one with the bottom. Okay. Glycogen phosphorylase A is converted from the R state into the T state by glucose. By glucose. Well, if the cell, the body has plenty of glucose, we sure as heck don't want to be breaking down glycogen, right? The answer is right. Okay? And therefore, we convert this guy into the T state so it doesn't break down much glycogen. However, when glucose supplies run out, look what happens to this form of the enzyme. It automatically flips into the R state. The reason we think about the phosphorylated form as being more active is there's not commonly a lot of glucose sitting around. There's not a lot of glucose sitting around. So if we have the A form of glycogen phosphorylase, that is the phosphorylated form, it's almost always going to be present over here in the R state breaking down glycogen. Okay. So the allosteric regulation is superimposed on top of the covalent modification. I'm going to talk about the covalent modification in a second, how it's controlled. But to understand the overall regulation of glycogen phosphorylase, we have to think about not only the allosteric regulation, but also the covalent modification. Okay. Questions about what I've said so far? Yeah. Do we see cooperativity in the binding of one phosphate versus the other? So cooperativity would happen largely with respect to substrate. This is not a substrate. So the answer is basically no. Okay. Clear as mud? Ready to get through this? All right. We'll get there. All right. Now, how does phosphorylation or dephosphorylation of glycogen phosphorylase occur? Well, there's an enzyme called phosphorylase kinase. Phosphorylase kinase, okay, let's think about what the name tells us. Kinase says puts a phosphate onto. Phosphorylase is what it puts it onto. So phosphorylase kinase is the enzyme that puts phosphate onto glycogen phosphorylase. It puts a phosphate onto glycogen phosphorylase. All right? Well, it can't be as simple as that, because if it did, as long as it's sitting around the cell, it would always be putting phosphate onto glycogen phosphorylase. All of my glycogen phosphorylase would be in the A form, and would almost always want to be breaking down my glycogen. There must be some other regulation, and there is other regulation. Phosphorylase kinase itself is regulated. Okay? Now, this is a regulation you've actually seen before. Well, you haven't seen this one, but okay. Let me come back to this one. I'll tell you what, that'll confuse you. That wasn't the one I wanted, okay? And that's not what I wanted. Blast it, where am I at? Here. Now, you've seen this picture before. This is the epinephrine scheme. The epinephrine scheme goes through a 7TM. 7TM gets activated. Activation of the 7TM causes a G protein to bind GTP, which causes it to interact with adenylate cyclase, which causes it to make cyclic AMP, which causes it to activate protein kinase. That much you've seen so far. You've seen other things that protein kinase can phosphorylate, like pyruvate kinase. Now look what this guy phosphorylates. It phosphorylates phosphorylase kinase, converting it from the inactive form in red to the active form in blue. Now we see how cells can turn on phosphorylase kinase and how phosphorylase kinase can phosphorylate glycogen phosphorylase. This makes really, what did I say?
The alliteration is getting out of
hand. Oh, yeah. The phosphorylase are getting there, aren't they? Yeah, there's a lot of phosphorylase there. Okay? Now this is really cool. Grizzly bear comes chasing me. My body says, need glucose. Dump epinephrine. We dump epinephrine. Activate. Oh, come on, you turkey. Activate. We activate. Okay. The G protein. G protein activates this, activates this. We're activating what? We're activating the breakdown of glycogen. Our body is getting a ton of glucose dumped. Remember when I talked about epinephrine before and I said it was called adrenaline? Because when we get spooked, our blood glucose levels rise very rapidly because of this. This is one of the ways in which those glucose levels rise. Okay? Very cool. Questions about that? Yes, we'll have to turn it off too. Don't worry, we'll get to that. But at the moment, we're just turning it on. All right. Well, before we talk about turning it off, now I need to go back to that uglier figure and describe to you. Yeah. It's a very simple figure. The book likes to make this look very complicated, but it's not. Okay? Let's see. It's succeeding. The end is near. All right. Phosphorylase kinase in the inactive form is sitting over here on the left. Phosphorylase kinase in the fully active form is sitting over here on the right. All right? What in the heck is all this business in here? All right? Well, you know when phosphorylase kinase is active, it will convert glycogen phosphorylase B into glycogen phosphorylase A. Puts phosphates onto things. That's what a kinase does. What does it mean to say it's partly active and it's partly active and what in the heck is going on there? Let's look at this thing, this top scheme for the moment. All right? Inactive. Protein kinase A comes along, puts phosphates on it. It becomes partly active. That means there's more to the activation than what I showed you on that scheme. How does it get fully active? It gets fully active if it gets phosphorylated and it binds to calcium. Okay? Which one happens first? What this figure is trying to tell you is it doesn't matter which one happens first. It can get a phosphate first and then it can get calcium, or it can get calcium first and then get phosphorylated. The bottom line is it's maximally active when it's phosphorylated and it has calcium. Now, I'm going to tell you the physiological significance of this in a second, but I want you to understand what this is telling you. It's very simple. Inactive, I can get phosphorylated and then get calcium. I can get calcium and then I can get phosphorylated. That's really all it's saying. Why is this physiologically relevant? Well, muscular contraction is caused by the release of
calcium.
So when I take off on my run, calcium levels in my muscles are going high. Before any hormonal stimulation happens, I'm already turning on phosphorylase kinase to a limited extent. I'm already starting the breakdown of glycogen before the grizzly bear has even had a chance to get close to me. The very first thing I need is glucose instantaneously. And that's what this calcium activation is giving you. A few seconds later, when the hormones kick in, epinephrine goes through its signaling scheme. This guy is sitting here already doing a bit of its business, but now it gets a jump start with phosphorylation, and bang, I'm really breaking down, or really activating glycogen phosphorylase so that I can break down glycogen in big terms. Yes? So glycogen phosphorylase B has an R state and a T state, yes. The R state, as I said, will be more active in breaking down glycogen than will the T state.
So it still does, but just phosphorylase A does a better job.
So, well, okay, so she says that phosphorylase A does a better job. No, it depends on the allosteric. You have to look at all the factors that's there. So people tend to say that the phosphorylated form is more active, but it's for the reason I stated. That it's more active because usually we don't have glucose laying around. Usually we have no glucose, in which case we have the R state. Usually we have the T state favored with the B based on what's there. But those things aren't fixed in stone. So let's think about that B, because it's a good question. It's a good place to think about this. I take off, and I've got a few seconds before my hormones are going to kick in and signal my muscle cells, start breaking this stuff down. If I have to really go very quickly, what's going to happen to my ATP levels? Down? Okay, we've talked about one thing that'll help bring them up. What is it? Creatine phosphate, right? Creatine phosphate will help bring them up. But that doesn't give me too much more. So now my ATP levels, I've gotten all I can get on my creatine phosphate. My hormones haven't kicked in. What happens to my ATP levels? Right? They start falling. When they start falling, what starts rising? AMP. And what is AMP going to do to glycogen phosphorylase B? It's going to convert it into the R state. These enzymes explain our physiology. I mean, it's really cool. So even before my hormones arrive, my glycogen phosphorylase B doesn't even have to wait for this process. It can start breaking down glycogen by flipping into the R state because AMP levels are high. I'm in trouble when my AMP levels are high. That's why I start breaking that down. Does that help answer your question? Cool stuff. Yes, sir.
In practice, is calcium bound form a little bit more active since muscular activity of any kind is going to sort of favor that?
Yeah. I don't know if the calcium form or the phosphorylated form is more active. I honestly don't know. Don't know. But this one's going to be activated more rapidly than this one is. I can tell you that much. Because this is going to happen as soon as you do muscular contraction. Yes? So his question is, in an emergency situation, will we consider phosphorylase B first? And the answer is not necessarily. What this emergency situation is telling us here is that we can, even in a very rapid emergency, convert B into A. So it doesn't say that, no. So, okay, so what I said was that AMP levels will go higher, right? But this is happening even before that happens. This is happening almost instantaneously. So some of the B is getting converted into some of the A before the AMP levels even happen. So you don't want to place an order necessarily on these. These are all contributing factors to helping you release that glucose when you need it. Those are very, very important considerations. Does that answer your question? I see another hand back here. All right, hands back here. Yeah.
So does phosphorylation or the binding to calcium, they kind of work in a cooperative
sense? Does phosphorylation and calcium work in a cooperative sense? They can. Okay. So let's imagine the following scenario. It's a good question, man. Okay. So let's imagine the following situation. I'm standing up in front of the lecture, and I decide to jog over here, right? And then I decide, okay, I'm going to jog back over here. No grizzly bears chasing me. I'm doing routine exercise, right? So I need a little bit of glycogen, right? If all of a sudden the grizzly bear starts chasing me, I want that boost. And that's how they work together, okay? So I want to have a certain level of glucose being released as I need it for just routine exercise purposes, but I'm not going to have the epinephrine signaling going on all the time because most of the time I don't have that happening. But when my epinephrine signaling kicks in and I'm exercising, that's when I want that big boost. That's really how they work together. I'm bouncing. No, I'm not. The ball is bouncing. Follow the bouncing ball. Other questions? There was another hand. Okay. Yeah.
So could it be said that if you're already exercising or doing muscular activity and then you get a shock, you're going to have a larger net boost than if you're just sitting in a chair and you get some shocking news or
yeah. So his question is basically sort of the corollary to Min's question, which is, do you get a boost if you have something else happening when you're, let's say, sitting around, you know, and then you have to run and so forth? Yeah, I mean, so they two really do work together to make get that jump. And again, the order isn't significant. If you're sitting here and all of a sudden you get news that, oh my God, you know, my parents have been in an automobile accident, epinephrine's going to dump. You're going to have a dump. It's going to happen with that. And then how your body responds to that. If your response is to get up and run or scream or something like that, then you've got that. Okay. Yeah.
Can a partly activated phosphorylase have to be fully active?
No. Partly active simply means it's just not doing it as efficiently. But when it's partly active, it's doing this. It does not have to be fully active. That's the point. So partly active, this guy will cause that to happen. this guy will cause that to happen. It's just less efficient in either of these forms than this one is. But it does not have to get to this form. No, no. That's why I say it's fully active versus partly active. Okay? Okay, good questions. All right, so that's very cool. We see something about how our body works with respect to things. There are actually two ways in which we can activate this pathway. One is epinephrine, and there's a similar path, a similar molecule called glucagon. I like to think of glucagon. Glucagon's a hormone also. It's a peptide hormone. And it's like what I like to think of as glucose all gone. Okay? Glucose all gone. Your liver responds to glucagon. Your muscles don't. But glucagon has exactly the same effect that epinephrine does. It causes breakdown of glycogen to release to the body. Remember the role the liver plays in modulating levels of glucose. When glucose levels fall, you don't want to have a grizzly bear kick them back up. The liver has to sense that we need to put some glucose out in those situations that aren't emergency situations. Glucagon is released by our body. It's bound in the liver, and the liver starts breaking down glycogen to modulate those glucose levels in the bloodstream. Glucagon is only bound by the liver, yes. Okay, now, I haven't talked yet about how we turn the process off. I will show you that in a second. But to start that process, or telling you that process, I need to tell you how glycogen synthesis is regulated. Okay? Glycogen synthesis is regulated. So glycogen synthesis is regulated through control of glycogen synthase. And while there are some effects of phosphorylation, dephosphorylation, and allosteric effects, we don't talk about them here. We will largely examine regulation of glycogen synthase by phosphorylation. Okay? That's largely how we're going to consider glycogen synthase. All right. Well, let me just give you a clue of what's going to come. We saw that phosphorylation of glycogen phosphorylase caused it to become more active, right? If we understand the principle of reciprocal regulation, what do you suppose is going to cause glycogen synthase to become less active? Phosphorylation. Exactly the same thing, having opposite effects on the two enzymes. Phosphorylation of glycogen synthase is going to make it much less active. How do we phosphorylate glycogen synthase? If you were guessing, what would you say? Protein kinase A. It's a beautiful scheme, folks. This is a really beautiful scheme. Protein kinase A phosphorylates it and turns it off. Okay? Look at this. Here's the same scheme you saw before. Last time we took it down to over here. Okay? Protein kinase A activated phosphorylase kinase that converted phosphorylase B to A. Protein kinase A works directly on glycogen synthase and converts it into the B form. Now, notice that they're using the B form to designate the inactive form, or less active form. Okay? Less active is what they call inactive here. All right? Notice that in this case, in the case of the phosphorylase, in the glycogen phosphorylase, no phosphate means B form. In the case of glycogen synthase, phosphate means B form. So A and B doesn't tell us phosphorylated state. It tells us relatively active or relatively inactive. All right. This makes sense. We want to turn off the synthase when we're turning on the glycogen phosphorylase, because the glycogen phosphorylase is going to break down glycogen. We want to turn around and do a futile cycle and start making glycogen at the same time. Not a good idea. Okay. Now, how do we reverse this process? Okay. Well, reversing the process is going to start taking phosphates off of things, and we take a phosphate off of here, what's going to happen to it? It's going to become active. We take a phosphate off of this guy, what's going to happen to it? Less active. We take a phosphate off of this guy, what's going to happen to it? Yeah. All right, so we see that if we take phosphates off, what's that?
Less
cascade.
A cascade going the other direction. Yeah. We're climbing up the hill. You thought water couldn't go uphill, but we're going up the hill. One enzyme does all this. One enzyme. This is good. Phosphoprotein phosphatase, the one you've already seen. It was involved in the PFK2 regulation, phosphoprotein phosphatase. What was it I said activated phosphoprotein phosphatase? Oh, man, that was last lecture. Was that Lucy? No. What activates phosphoprotein phosphatase is insulin. Ah, so we see that epinephrine and insulin are doing very different things. Epinephrine is increasing blood glucose. Insulin is decreasing blood glucose. Well, this is a problem. Glucose is a poison. The cell is being stimulated by insulin to take in all this glucose. If we don't do something with that, we just poisoned ourselves. What do we do with it? Ah, insulin also activates glycogen synthesis. So all that glucose starts becoming glycogen. It starts becoming glycogen. As a consequence, glucose concentration in the cell falls because the glucose is being converted into glycogen. Now that's a really cool process, a really, really cool process. Reciprocal regulation, balancing these things, is making for a phenomenal response, okay? These are tremendous responses that are happening as a result of, in this case, fear. In this case, over here, eating a meal. Yes, sir?
I'm sorry, could you repeat the name of the enzyme that dephosphorylates?
Yes. The enzyme that takes the phosphates off of all of these molecules is known as phosphoprotein phosphatase. I'm sorry? I want to use the one the book uses, and I'm going to come to that in just a second. So let me do it. They call it PP1. That's what it is. PP1, phosphoprotein phosphatase 1. Okay? Different books use different designations. Some call it PPI. I don't like that, but that's what some books would call it. All right. This is a confusing figure. I don't recommend that you use it to try to understand the big picture, because I have to think about it myself every time I show this figure, and I frequently think about it wrong. Okay? So it's trying to show you stimulation of protein kinase A moves us downwards, and moving us downwards moves us in the direction of this and the direction of this. It's telling us that glycogen, that insulin moves us upwards, which means activation of this, movement to this direction, and movement to this direction, and movement to this direction. Okay? It's not the best figure. If it helps you, great. I can assure you I'm not going to ask you to reproduce this figure. Okay? Yes, sir?
No, I just have a real quick question. You just said that that PP1 was used to be called PPI, or in other books?
Some books call it PPI, yeah.
But we used an abbreviation for PPI last week, and I was curious if that was the same.
That's one of the reasons I don't like that abbreviation. We're calling it PP1.
Okay. So then PPI is separate from the UDP glucose.
So what the PPI I used last term is what's called PP lowercase I. All right. What the books call it sometimes is PP capital I. Okay. It's just confusing. So PP1 makes more sense. Okay. The most sense, if you just call it phosphoprotein phosphatase, then you don't have any question. Think about it. The name again tells us what it does. Phosphoprotein. Right? A protein that has phosphates on it. Phosphatase. What does a phosphatase do? It takes phosphates off of things. So phosphoprotein phosphatase takes phosphates off of proteins that have them. Okay, I see people getting a little restless. This might be a good time for us to get note cards, and I will finish everything up on Friday. Please come up and get one note card. Everybody get their own. Let's not do it here. Let me get it. You're just getting in the way. So come back and I'll ask you correctly, okay? Yeah, there you go.